गुड आफ्टरनून. ओके फाइन फाइन देन लेट्स स्टार्ट आवर क्लास. ओके सो टुडे इज द वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद द लास्ट टॉपिक ऑफ स्पेशल सेंसेस दैट इज योर ईयर. ओके so today's topic will be the functional anatomy as well as the functions of different parts of the ear. I assume that you must have already studied this portion in your anatomy classes and you are well aware of the structures present in the ear. So we are just going to give up all the structures along with the functions of each structure. So coming to the introduction to the topic that we are going to study today, that is the anatomy of ear. Okay, so the receptor cell in ear are your hair cells, and these hair cells are important for two important functions. One is your hearing and the other one is your equilibrium. Okay, so our main focus today will be the hearing part of your hair cells. Now anatomically, ear is divided into three parts. First outer ear, that is your external ear, then comes your middle ear, and the inner ear, that is your internal ear. External, middle and inner ear. Now the organ for hearing, that is the auditory pathway, auditory apparatus, or you term it as your cochlea, is present in your inner ear. And the organ for equilibrium is your vestibular apparatus. So organ for hearing or the auditory apparatus is your cochlea, and the organ for your equilibrium is your vestibular apparatus. Now the external ear, middle ear and cochlea of the inner ear are the components of the hearing system. So starting with the external ear, we are going to study each of the components and their function. Now the vestibular apparatus, which consists of your saccule, utricle and the three semicircular canals, are concerned with the maintenance of your body equilibrium. So three structures, external, middle and cochlea, are concerned with your auditory apparatus, and the vestibular apparatus is consist of the saccule, utricle and the three semicircular canals. Now coming to the first one, that is the external ear. Okay, so the external ear consists of two structures. One is your auricle or pinna, and the other one is your external auditory meatus. Now the pinna or auricle, okay, so it consists of a single convoluted plate of elastic cartilage, which is covered by your skin and attached to the pericardium. Depression in the auricle, which forms the orifice of your external auditory meatus, is termed as your concha. Now in lower animals, pinna is very important, because they get that structure is movable, okay, by the muscular actions alongside the direction of sound. But in humans, it is a rudimentary structure and it is not movable. But the importance of this structure is it collects and reflects the sound waves into the external auditory canal. And this is possible due to the peculiar shape of the structure, that is your pinna. And what it does, it helps to locate the sound or the source of sound For example, if the sound is coming in front or behind your head. So this is why in humans this structure is important to collect and reflect the sound waves into your external auditory meatus. Now the second structure in your external ear is your external auditory meatus. So from where to where? It extends from your pinna to your tympanic membrane, and it consists of two portions. The first external part that consists of 1/3 portion, and it comprises your cartilaginous portion, and the next internal part that comprises of your 2/3 portion, and it comprises the bony portion. So 1/3 cartilaginous portion and 2/3 bony portion. It is lined by skin, which is in cartilaginous part secrete the wax, okay, and oil, that is from your sebaceous glands. Then coming to the function of this structure, that is the external auditory meatus, it will conduct the sound waves to the middle ear. So along with your pinna or auricle, the external auditory meatus, both will try to locate the sound, locate the source of sound, and allow it passage from external into your second structure, that is your middle ear. So here you can see the diagram. Okay, so just the auricle, okay, auricle here, and this is your external ear, okay, and the connection from auricle to the middle ear, that is your external auditory meatus. So the next structure is your tympanic membrane, that is the start of your middle ear. Okay, now the second part of the ear, that is your middle ear. So coming to the walls of the middle ear, so it has got six structures. The middle ear is otherwise termed as your tympanic cavity, okay, and it is present in the petrous part of your temporal bone. What are the six structures? Four walls and a roof and a floor. So what are the four walls? Anterior, posterior, medial and lateral. Roof, floor, anterior, posterior, medial and lateral wall. So let's see what these structures comprises of and from where to where they are stretched. Okay, so the anterior wall, it opens to the exterior via your eustachian tube and at the level of your nasopharynx. This is the anterior wall. Next come to the posterior wall. It communicates with the mastoid air cells, that is the air cavities in the mastoid process of temporal bone, through a space called as a tympanic antrum. And why is this structure important? Because whenever there is infections in the middle ear, that will spread to the mastoid air cells, okay, they can cause a disease termed as your mastoiditis. Okay, so infections of middle ear, mainly in the posterior wall, okay, which that is communicating with the mastoid air cells, so they can cause a disease termed as your mastoiditis. Now the medial wall, it consists of two very small membranes, okay, and covered openings, that is your oval window and round window, and this it separates the middle ear from the internal ear. So this oval window and round window structure we will study in the internal ear. Okay, so the lateral wall, it is formed by your tympanic membrane that will separate the external ear from the middle ear. So four walls: anterior, posterior, medial and lateral, and two other structures, that is floor and roof. So the floor, bony floor, it separates the middle ear from the jugular fossa, and the roof is formed by the tegmen tympani that will separate it from the middle cranial fossa. Also the middle ear consists of three mil ossicles and two ossicular muscles. Okay. So anatomy wise, the middle ear and the internal ear. Middle ear, because it consists of so many structures that are required for your processing of the sound. Okay, before it reaches the inner ear. And the inner ear, because it consists of the hair cells or the receptors for your sound sensation. So these two structures in the ear are very, very important, and you need to remember all those minute little structures, those that are involved in your processing of your sensation. Okay, so this structure, it is a diagrammatic representation of your middle ear cavity. Okay, the bones, the tympanic membrane, the eustachian tube, oval window and round window, and the three bones. Now coming to the tympanic membrane, okay, it's otherwise termed as your eardrum. It's a very thin, elastic, semi-transparent conical membrane. The apex called as ambo, and which is towards your middle ear. It is made up of collagen and elastic fibers, and the inner surface is lined by your mucous membrane, and the outer is covered by your skin. Why is this structure important? Again, any inflammation in the tympanic membrane, it will cause a disease termed as your tympanitis. Okay, tympanitis. What is the functions of this tympanic membrane? It is very, very, very important structure. To cut it short, it dampens the sound waves. And why this is important, you will study in the next topic, next class. Okay, what is the meaning of this? Dampening the sound waves. That means first sound waves arrives in the external ear. Okay. Then from the external ear, it will has to pass into the middle ear. So before it passes to the middle ear, it will strike the tympanic membrane and will make it, or it will vibrate. The tympanic membrane will vibrate. Now how much vibration is, it is equal to the frequency of the sound wave. So this is a very, very sensitive membrane, okay, which acts due to pressure changes, and therefore it is termed as a resonator. Okay, resonator. Okay, because it is extremely sensitive to your pressure changes. So from the tympanic membrane, the vibrations will get transmitted to the malleus, that are the bones. Okay, and if, or you can say that cessation of sound wave, if the sound wave stops, then there will be dampening the sound, because it will quickly stop vibrating, because the receptor, or you can say the stimulus, is the sound wave, and hence the vibration. The next function except for this is, it acts as a mechanical barrier to prevent any type of foreign particles or dust or secretions entering into the middle ear, because the middle ear is very, very sensitive, and there shouldn't be any entry of any foreign particles. So it acts as a mechanical barrier. First, it helps in dampening of the sound waves. Second, it is a transmitter of sound from your external ear into your internal ear, and third, it acts as a mechanical barrier. Now the next structure in your middle ear is your auditory ossicles, or the bones. So the three very small bones are termed as your malleus, incus and stapes. So the other name for malleus, because it looks like, say, hammer, and incus is anvil, and stapes, stirrup. Okay, Now coming to each of the small bones, the handle of the malleus or the manubrium, these details you must have already studied in your anatomy part, but what is important I am just going to teach you. Okay, so the handle of the malleus or the manubrium, it is attached to the internal surface of the tympanic membrane. So the tympanic membrane is in connection with the malleus. So the vibration from the tympanic membrane will come to this malleus. So malleus articulates with the body of incus, that in turn articulates with the head of steps. So tympanic membrane, then comes your malleus, then comes your incus, and the last one is your step. So this way the vibrations is moving. So here is the structure of the tympanic membrane. Okay, so here you can see it is attached to the malleus, from here to the incus, and lastly to the steps. Okay, the foot plate of steps from here is attached to the oval window or the fenestra vestibuli. Okay, so pressure waves travel through the ossicular chain and produce vibrations of the foot plate of steps, which then transmit the vibration to the perilymph of inner ear through your oval window. So the vibration from the external ear, so to start with, from pinna to the external auditory meatus, then coming to the tympanic membrane, then the three bony structures, now through the oval window is transmitted to your inner ear. Okay, now the round window, which is present below the oval window, is enclosed by a flexible membrane called a secondary tympanic membrane. About this we will study later on. Okay, so why is this steps or the foot plate of steps very very important, and the structure of this is of importance? Okay, firstly it is transmitting the impulses from the other bones to your inner ear. Okay, if suppose there is a disease, that is your otosclerosis. Okay, what is it? There is a bony fixation of the steps, okay, to the wall of your fenestra vestibuli. It will result in the deafness due to the loss of your vibrating capacity. If this happens, then there will be loss of sensation, and the vibrations may not pass to the next segment, that is your inner ear. So after the bones, coming to the muscles, okay, ossicular muscles. So two, that is your stapedius and tensor tympani. So the very tiny skeletal muscles which are attached to your steps and malleus. Functions of this tensor tympani muscles is it will make the tympanic membrane very very responsive to your sound waves. Okay, so how it does, the muscle will pull the handle of the malleus inwards, thereby increasing the tension of your tympanic membrane, and thus this tympanic membrane becomes more responsive to your sound waves. Okay, the other one is the stapedius. It is a very smallest skeletal muscle in the body, and it acts during loud noise. What it happens, it contracts and pulls the foot plate of steps out from the oval window, dampening the vibrations transmitted to the inner ear. So whenever there is paralysis, then the patient is abnormally sensitive to loud sounds. One more thing, this ossicular muscles are concerned, especially your tensor tympani and stapedius, is a reflex termed as your tympanic reflex or acoustic reflex. Okay, so because of these two muscles and the way they react when the sound reaches them, okay, these two are termed as your protective reflex actions. Okay, why? Because they will decrease the damage to the inner ear by dampening the vibrations transmitted. Okay, and sudden loud sound may damage your inner ear. So this ultimately will check the stimulation, or the, you can say, the overstimulation of the hair cells, which may ultimately damage your cochlea. Okay, so this tympanic reflex or your acoustic reflex or your protective reflex is very, very important function of this ossicular muscles, especially your SR tympani. Now coming to the functions of the middle ear muscles. First, as reflex, it prevents damage to the cochlea. Then second, improve sound transmission to the cochlea in the range of voice communication while decreasing the responses of frequencies above and below this range, and suppress the self-generated sounds. Okay, so the functions of these two ear muscles mainly is your tympanic reflex to prevent the damage to the cochlea. The next structure is your Eustachian tube. It connects the middle ear with the pharynx, and the function is to equalize the air pressure on both sides of the tympanic membrane. Why this equalization of air pressure important as a component while the passage of the sound, we will study in the next class. Okay, so it helps the membrane to vibrate at the same frequency as the sound waves. This vibration at the same frequency, this term same frequency, I am using it in each and everything. So this same frequency vibration, why this is important, what is the importance of this, and why it is required before being transmitted into your inner ear and to the hair cells, that we will see in next class. Okay, now okay, functions of the middle ear. So it will receive sound waves, transmit the sound waves, amplification of sound waves, equalization of air pressure by your Eustachian tube, okay, and will protect against your prolonged loud sound via your muscle. So these are the functions of the middle ear. The middle ear, okay, it is sometimes known as your impedance matching device. What is this term? Impedance. Okay, that means resistance. Okay, resistance. So how this applies to this middle ear? Okay, so when the sound waves travel from your air to water, what happens around most of the sound energy, say 99.5% of the sound energy, will get reflected because it's the water medium. Okay, so how much is left? Only 0.5% is left. So if only such less amount of sound energy will reach to your oval window, okay, then that much of amount of energy will also reach the inner ear. So here what is important? Amplification of sounds, which is the function of this middle ear. So this amplification of sound waves will help to compensate the rest amount of sound energy to activate the hair cells. So this is known as your impedance or resistance matching, and the middle ear is termed as your impedance matching device. Now coming to the last portion of the ear, the inner ear. Okay, so it is situated in the petrous part of the temporal bone, also termed as your labyrinth, due to the presence of a complicated series of canals. Okay, and it consists of the sense of organ of hearing and equilibrium. The sense organ for hearing is your cochlea or the auditory apparatus, and the sense organ for equilibrium is your vestibular apparatus. Now the vestibular apparatus again will be taught to you in a separate class. We will stress here about the cochlea, and the function of the cochlea is transduction of sound energy into your action potential in cochlear nerve fiber. So this is nothing but equal to the retina of your eye. Okay, so here also there are hair cells which have different layers of structures which help in the transition of sound waves or conversion of the sound wave into your action potential, so that it can pass through the cochlear nerve fiber and reach your cortex. So structurally, this inner ear, it is divided into an outer bony labyrinth that houses an inner membranous labyrinth. The bony labyrinth consists of a fluid called as your perilymph that surrounds the membranous labyrinth. So when I told you that the energy sound waves travel from air to water, I mean this liquids, okay, because after getting transmitted through the oval window to the inside the inner window, so it has to pass through this fluid, that is your perilymph and your endolymph. So bony labyrinth consists of perilymph and the membranous labyrinth consists of your endolymph. The membranous labyrinth consists of the auditory apparatus, that is your cochlea, the vestibular apparatus, that is your saccule, utricle and your semicircular canals, and the bony labyrinth surrounds your membranous labyrinth. Okay, so see the diagram of your membranous labyrinth. The propel structures, okay, and see saccule, cochlear duct, cochlea, okay, utricle, ampullae and the semicircular canals. Again here this is the bony labyrinth. Then comes your B structure is your membranous labyrinth, and this is a cut section of your bony labyrinth to show the position of your membranous labyrinth. Cochlea, okay, again a very important structure of your inner ear. It is a snail shaped fluid filled coiled, okay. So outer bony spiral canal houses the inner membranous cochlear duct. Two structure, bony spinal spiral canal and membranous cochlear duct. So coming to the bony cochlea, it is the part of bony labyrinth. So in humans, the cochlea is around 35 mm in length and makes 2 and 3/4 turns around a central bony core termed as your modulus. This cochlear vessels and the nerves, they will traverse through this structure. This is the cross section view of your cochlea that shows the different layers. Okay, the organ of cochlear duct and the basilar membrane, skeletal tympani, spiral ganglion, resinous membrane, all these structures along with their functions in your transmission of auditory sensations will study in the hair cells part. Okay, organ of Corti, cochlear duct, stria vascularis, basilar membrane, stria tympani, spiral ganglion, resinous membrane and scala vestibuli. Now the bony part we have finished. Coming to the membranous cochlea, okay, or the cochlear duct. It is like a tube that follows the spiral shape of your bony cochlea, and it is filled with endolymph, and it is part of your membranous labyrinth. So the cross-sectional view of cochlea, that is your resinous membrane, bacillus membrane, will divide the cochlea into three fluid filled compartments, that are your scala vestibuli, scala media and your scala tympani. Each one of them and their functions. Okay, scala vestibuli. It is the gap above your resinous membrane which is filled with your perilymph. Okay, at the base of cochlea it is separated from the middle ear by your oval window, and at the apex of the cochlea it is continuous with the scala tympani through a small opening called as your helicotremor. The scala media, okay, again this is very important structure because it consists of very high concentration of sodium potassium ATPs. I'll tell you, that is the compartment between your resinous and your basilar membrane. It is filled with endolymph secreted by a layer of fibrous tissue, vascular tissues known as your stria vascularis. And what is the importance of this structure? The stria vascularis, it will pump out potassium, okay, potassium and sodium, okay, potassium into and sodium out of your scala media, okay, and so the concentration of potassium is more inside the scala media. And this is because of the presence of very high concentration of your sodium potassium ATPase in your stria vascularis. Now the rest structures, that as your resinous membrane, basilar membrane and the stria vascularis, will form the three walls of your cochlear duct. The basilar membrane importance because it houses the organ of Corti that locates the receptor cells for hearing. The last structure, scala tympani, it is the space below the basilar membrane fit with your perilymph. So the two liquid, that is your endolymph and perilymph and its organs. Okay, so important organ in your inner ear, that is your organ of Corti. Why it's important? Because it consists of your hair cells. So the spiral organ, which is located on the basilar membrane, contains the receptors for hearing, that those are your hair cells. It also consists of your associated nerve terminals, supporting cells, tunnel of Corti, basilar membrane, tectoral membrane and your reticular lamina. So what are the different layers of the organ of Corti? Let's see. Okay, so this is the organ of Corti. So you can say it has the rod of Corti, the hair cells, the supporting cells, okay, and lastly the tectoral membrane. So four structures we are going to see here in the organ of Corti: rod of Corti, the hair cells, that is the inner and outer hair cells, okay, then we will see the supporting cells, and lastly the tectorial membrane. So coming to the first one, the rods of Corti. Similarly, as I told you, remember different layers or in the retina. Similarly, you have to remember the different layers in your organ of Corti. So what are the rods of Corti? So before I tell you the structure of these rods of Corti, the function of this structure is not clearly known till now. So what are these? These are projections divided into inner and outer rods from your basal membrane into your scala media. So in between two rods, there is a tunnel of Corti which consists of a fluid, Corti lymph. The hair cells is the next. Okay, so again of two types, that is inner hair cells and outer hair cells. So these are your receptor cells that will transduce the sound energy into your electrical energy. They lie on the basilar membrane. Okay, the inner hair cells, they will form a single row of cells internal to the inner rod, and which are function is they are responsible for your fine auditory transmission. And the inner hair cells are very less in number compared to your outer hair cells. So outer hair cells, they are very numerous in number, and they are arranged in three or four layers. Okay, external, that is lateral to the outer rod. And the function of this outer hair cells is detecting the presence of sound. So the inner hair cells will be responsible for your fine auditory transmission, and the outer hair cells are responsible for detection or detecting the presence of sound. So they mainly receive efferent innervation from your olivary complex and are concerned with modulating functions of your inner hair cells. So two type of hair cells, that is inner and outer hair cells. Along with this inner and outer hair cells, there are four types of supporting cells. So first one is your inner phalangeal cells. They will support the inner hair cells, inner phalangeal cells. Next is your Dieter's cell or your outer phalangeal cells. They are situated between your outer hair cells and will provide support to your outer hair cells. So inner phalangeal cells will provide support to the inner hair cells, and outer phalangeal cells will provide support to your outer hair cells. Otherwise, these are termed as your Dieter's cells. Alongside with these two, there are other two cells, that is your Hansen's cells and your Claudius cells. So with these two, the Hansen's, they lie outside the Dieter's cells, and Claudius cells, they lie outside the Hansen's cells. So four type of supporting cells along with your inner hair cells and your outer hair cells. So you have rods of Corti. So you can see here, you have a rods of Corti. Then you have your outer hair cells. Okay, here, and the inner hair cells. And along with that, you have the supporting cells, that is your Dieter's cells. Okay, we will see in another diagram. See here. Okay, so these are your outer hair cells, Hansen's cells, Claudius cells. Okay, these are your rods of Corti, the pillar cells, the inner phalangeal cells. Okay, supporting your inner cells, and the outer phalangeal cells supporting your outer hair cells. So inner hair cell, inner phalangeal cell, outer hair cells, outer phalangeal cells, and the rest two that lies nearby to your Dieter's cells is your Hansen's cells, and next to your Hansen's cells is your Claudius cells. So these are the structures of the organ of Corti. The last structure that remains is your tectorial membrane. So it consists of the gelatinous matrix with very delicate fibers. It is very thin but a very stiff membrane which is made up of glycoprotein material, and the membrane is attached to the upper surface of the spinal lamina, and a free edge extends just beyond the outermost neuroepithelial cells. So these are the four important structures of organ of Potty. So organ of Potty is important in your examination point of view. You have to remember this along with your diagram. Okay, so the most relevant diagram which you find in your book and you can learn it, please do revise with the diagram. So if you see in today's chapter, two important things for your exam is your middle ear, components of your middle ear, and the inner ear, that is your organ of Corti. So we have finished with today's class. So if you have any doubt, you can ask me. Next class, we will shift to the auditory pathway. Okay, what are the nerves that supply the hair cells, and how from the hair cells, that is from the organ of Corti, the sound is getting transmitted to the cortex. Okay, so external ear, middle ear, then the inner ear. Okay, so importance and how the sound waves are traveling from the external till the organ of Corti. You just need to know the structures which are involved in this transmission of sound waves, and the function of the middle ear, amplification, transmission, okay, conduction. So all these three things you have to remember. Any other doubts? Okay, so thank you all.